You know, Scott worked really hard here. Scott loves Nebraska. He'll always be a Husker. He's a Nebraskan. And he worked really, really hard here. He really wanted this thing to work. And I can tell you that I really wanted this thing to work. Our donors wanted it to work. Everybody wanted it to work. And so, in a way, it's unfortunate and sad that we're here today. So I want to thank Scott. I also want to thank Mickey Joseph for taking on this role. I felt like, you know, there's 9 games left in the season. And I think we owed it to the players. We owe it to our fans to give these players an opportunity these last 9 games. We've got good players on this football team. And so having a different voice and having some new energy and enthusiasm, I'm hoping can make a difference for this team. And then third and finally, I think at the end of the day, there has to be accountability. When you run a professional organization that has high standards, accountability has to matter. And, you know, Scott and I talked about this very clearly. 16-31 obviously was not at a level that was acceptable to us. So I met with Scott this morning at 11 o'clock. I'll just kind of walk you through the process of the day. I met with Scott at 11 o'clock and informed him. I want you to know that Scott was extremely collegial and he understood. I wasn't surprised because I know how much Scott loves this place. And I think that's really important. We then both had an opportunity to go down and meet with the team. We sent an email to our team. Most of the team was here, so we got to meet with our team. And Scott was with me, and I thank the team. And I thank Scott in front of the team for all of his hard work. I think the team really cares about Scott, and I know Scott really cares about the team. I then gave Scott an opportunity to spend time himself with the team. And so we all left, and Scott spent time with the team, and those conversations will remain with the team and Scott. And then finally, I invited Mickey Joseph, and Mickey came in about 11:45 and spoke to the team and walked them through some of the changes that he envisioned. I communicated to Mickey that Mickey's the head coach. I won't meddle in Mickey's decision-making process. I encouraged Mickey to be the head coach and make decisions as the head coach. And so he'll ultimately have an opportunity probably with all of you to explain. I think there will be some changes. He explained some of the changes with the team. There'll be some structural changes and things that I think Mickey believes in, which will be good going forward. He can explain all that to you. Just want to tell you a little bit about the process going forward, and we'll open it up to questions. Obviously, we're going to do a national search. You know, we're going to engage some third-party help, mostly for logistics and other things. Want you to know as well, and I would encourage our fans and everyone to recognize there will be a lot of rumors out there. There's going to be a lot of innuendo. I want you to know that these sort of decisions and processes are not made in a silo. I have a lot of great mentors and friends that we'll be working with. And ultimately, you know, in a prior life, I have relationships with a lot of coaches in this business, and I intend to reach out to a lot of people. And so if you hear that Trev Alberts reached out to XYZ coach, it doesn't mean that I've offered the job to XYZ coach. I think there's some fabulous coaches out there that have a perspective about our job that I could benefit from. And so I'm going to reach out to a lot of people. And so if you hear that Trev Alberts reached out to XYZ coach, it might very well be true. It doesn't mean that I'm trying to hire that coach. I'd like to get that perspective. I'd like to get a perspective of a coach who isn't here right now about our job and what the uniqueness is and the needs and those sorts of things. So just want to be clear about that process. Obviously, there's been some changes in college football with the early signing date and transfer portal. There are considerations as we go forward as well. But most importantly, I'm going to do everything I possibly can, like I think we did for Scott, to support Mickey Joseph and the staff as best we possibly can. It's a group of young men that they're hurting. And, you know, they care deeply about this place. And so we're going to do everything we can to support them and help them. They've got 9 games left. We've got a great opportunity this weekend against Oklahoma. And so we're going to support them as best we can going forward. All right. I guess we'll open it up from comments and questions here.
Why now as opposed to October or the end of the season?
It's a good question. It's a fair question, Annie. It's, you know, at this point I just felt like, as I mentioned earlier, we owed it to the players. you know, to give them a different voice, perhaps slightly different vision, give them some confidence and opportunity. We've got 9 games. We've got seniors on this team that have invested a lot for a long time. And I know how disruptive these changes are. You're not just affecting the player's life, you're affecting all the coaches and their family, and I understand that. But we needed to do something. We needed to inject something into this team to give them the confidence and hopefully help them compete. Nothing would please me more than to see a pretty significant change and help this team get over the hump and win some games.
The buyout was supposed to drop in half on October 1st. How did you handle that? Was there a negotiated settlement? Or did Scott get the $15 million?
There's no negotiated settlement. The University of Nebraska has a long history of living up to what we've agreed to. And so the contract is what the contract is. And, of course, the university will comply as we always do. I won't get into any discussions about outside boosters or any of that sort of thing. But
Trev, when did you actually make the decision? Last night?
Yeah, I think last night. Not a lot of slept. You know, didn't sleep a lot, Andy, and a lot of us didn't. But, you know, some real concern throughout the first couple games. And, you know, wanted this thing to work, wanted to give a little extra time. And I think last night and then through the night and then into this morning, I really felt like you know, we needed to make a change.
If they won, would that have changed? Like, if they get a stop?
You know, I don't know, Sam. I mean, I don't want to get into the what ifs if they stopped here on third down or got this. I mean, I don't think that's really healthy. We are where we are. We're 16-31, and I want to give this group of players an opportunity to have a different voice to try to win some games this year. Well, Steve, I want to first say, first of all, we have not engaged in any third-party folks. I have not talked to any agents of any football coaches. We were all in to help Scott be successful. Everybody wanted Scott to be successful, and I believe Scott wanted Scott to be successful as well. So, listen, yeah, anybody in my position has a group of folks that they admire. At the end of the day, for us, we need to, you know, get some clear definitions about what those coaching qualities look like. You know, what is our unique culture need in terms of coaching, and ultimately, what is our culture going to be as a team? So, yeah, there's a group of people that I'm well aware of and interested in, would like to talk to, and we'll go through that as we move forward. But right now, in the immediacy, Steve, we've got an opportunity to support the team as they move forward. I met with Mickey, and I told him, you know, we were going to do a national search, and we'll continue to do a national search, and we'll see how the season unfolds. But I think we have an opportunity, you know, to hire an outstanding coach that can lead our program, and I'd love to see Mickey, you know, grow into that, and we'll just see where it goes. But again, we'll do a national search, and if at that point, you know, Mickey is an obvious candidate. He'll be part of that conversation as well.
Trev, where do you know, I guess, what kind of expectations do you have for your program now? I mean, what do you think the ceiling is, and where would you like the team to go from here?
Well, I won't get into specific, you know, ceilings or where to go. Listen, we've said all along, I'd just love to see this team continue to grow, compete, make progress, have a team that represents the values of Nebraskans, be tough, win the line of scrimmage, do the fundamental things that teams need to do to win games, and I think we can get there. You know, we'll stop talking about championships or stop talking about things we used to do. We'll just get really process-oriented, detail-oriented, and ultimately, when you start doing those fundamental championship habits-type things, as I think about them, those types of wins and things follow. But we need to stop focusing on that. We need to start focusing on those small fundamental things that ultimately lead to those types of things. And so those are the things we'll do.
What are 3 or 4 qualities that you really want a good head coach? You hired many head coaches at other places. I'm talking intangibles, not necessarily.
You know, Sam, I've always believed that, you know, great coaches are people of character. You know, I think they're people managers. You know, they're culture builders. I think they're grinders. A lot of the great ones don't have a whole lot of hobbies. It's all they know, you know? And You know, so those types of things. And I think young people, as we've moved forward, have changed a little bit. So I think being able to identify and relate to the modern student athlete and all that they're going through and all of the new things like NIL and all those types of things are very important. But the basic fundamentals of authentic leadership, I mean, is this somebody that the players are willing to follow? I mean, it's just basic types of leadership things that are really, really important to me. And I like people who hate to lose. I like people who hate to lose more than they enjoy winning. And I got to be really careful when I say those things, because I certainly don't mean to infer and imply that our previous coach didn't have those things. And I want to be very clear about that. That's not fair to Scott. What I'm saying is that's what I have found. No matter if it's a football coach, basketball coach, or a volleyball coach, there's some very core and key fundamental characteristics that help to define each of them. And those are the types of things that I believe in as well.
Trev, when you look at the coaching market and just the salaries and how much they've gone up, how competitive can Nebraska be in this current market of coaching salaries?
Yeah, I mean, I'm well aware of where the market has shifted in terms of compensation. And at a place like Nebraska, you know, we're blessed to be in a position to meet market demand. And certainly resources won't be an impediment towards hiring the type of coach that we want to lead the Husker program. You know, Andy, I hadn't put a lot of thought into that, Andy, but I thought it would work, you know. And listen, we all have short memories, but Scott Frost was among the absolute leaders in that cycle of coaching. And Scott's a good football coach. Scott's going to go on and be a successful coach. I told him that this morning. And he agreed, you know, Scott's a good football coach. And the right situation for him will emerge, and I think he'll be very successful. I was determined to work with him and try to balance, Andy, that very delicate balance of not meddling, because it's the last thing I think administration should do, is start dictating to coaches how they operate their deal, but be supportive. And but it is what it is. It didn't work, and that's why we're here today.
What are some of the specific qualities Mickey has that made him right for this role?
Well, Mickey's an energetic guy. Some of you have interacted with him already. He's pretty black and white, and, you know, I was in there when he talked to the team, and I think, sees this as a real opportunity for him as well, professionally, and all of you will get a chance to talk to Mickey. You know, I think he has an infectious personality. I think that's important. You know, he's been some places, so I think that benefits him. I think he has some different feelings about structure and approach and how he'll handle practice and some different things. So there'll be some immediate, fairly significant changes into his approach. And he had a very poignant conversation with the team today that I thought they took very well. At the same time, I think, like Scott, Mickey will love them and seek to serve them. Well, I don't know if there's anything specific to, you know, how magnified the role is. You know, I certainly think it has to be somebody that has a servant leadership mentality, you know, that's here to serve young people, that perhaps sees a picture bigger than themselves, if you will. But I don't think anything specific. I mean, every single job in college football has challenges. This job has advantages to other jobs, and it has some disadvantages. It's the same thing with every job in college football. We have 1.8 million people in the state. That's not going to change. But we got some built-in advantages here. So we need to play to our strengths and build on those, right? And so the right kind of coach, I think, sees this as an opportunity to rebuild and build something special here. Sam, I don't know. And, you know, and I'm not trying to be flippant with you. If I knew, we would have made some changes. I don't know the answer to that question.
Did you see something in cross-coaching style with the
You know, I could spend a lot of time. I don't want to spend a lot of time going backwards and looking at and evaluating Scott, only because I think at this point it's a little unfair to Scott. We've moved on. You know, certainly there's things that you observe and you'd see and you'd say, well, maybe I'd do something different. We would have conversations. But at the end of the day, Scott Frost was the head coach. And I promise you, Scott made decisions that he thought were in the best interest of the University of Nebraska. They were genuine. He believed that in his heart. Okay? And so that's really important. I don't want to spend a lot of time evaluating Scott's performance over the last 5 years. I think, you know, at the end of the day, Scott's no longer the head coach here, and we'll move on and look forward to. I think you'll see some of those changes that, and you'll get to talk to Coach Joseph about that. But mostly I just want to salute Scott. And, you know, he'll always be a Husker, and he's from the great state of Nebraska and always be welcome here, and we want to support him in that role. Well, I do think there's some benefits in terms of making the decision when we've made it. I think this gives us an opportunity to really, you know, do the necessary work. We need to dive into a real process and a detail-oriented process that talks to a lot of people. And that's why I mentioned earlier, you're going to hear about a lot of names. That's good. That means we're going to talk to a lot of people because we're going to clearly define what our values are. And we're not going to hire coaches who don't believe in what we believe in, Sam. And so we need to take as long as it takes to find the right leader. So is there an ideal timeline? Sure. I mean, you could naturally look at some of these timelines, early signing date, and say it'd be really nice to be able to get the person in place by then because it would allow us to do that. But we won't make decisions or rush things just to get a coach hired. We're also not going to try to win the press conference. All right. At the end of the day, we need to hire the right leader and the right fit. And that's a really important thing here as well.
We talked to the recruits at all? Are we have a chance to visit with the recruits, or we let the coaches just kind of handle that from here on out?
I'll do whatever Mickey asked me to do. You know, I really enjoy talking to the recruits, prospective recruits. You've probably seen me out on the field, and I really enjoy talking to those young men. I will do anything I possibly can to be supportive of the football coaching staff, but I will not get in the way. And so ultimately, what I would do with Scott is every time we talked, I'd ask, how can I help? Am I doing anything that's counterproductive? I'll do the same thing with Mickey. What can I do to help? I want him to be successful because ultimately that means our young men are being successful. So I'll do whatever Mickey and the staff ask me to do. No, I think you guys will probably define my tenure. That's how it works. But I don't think about those kinds of things. You know, I'm no different than Scott. I love the University of Nebraska, and like I said earlier, I had really hoped that the day I got introduced here as the athletic director that I'd never have to be doing this. I really thought that I could work with Scott, and that's what everybody wanted. So. We'll do the right things. We'll do the best that we can. Every decision we make here, whether it's right or wrong, we'll learn later. But they are always done with what we think is in the best long-term interest of the University of Nebraska and our athletic department. And this place will always be bigger than any one person. And that is the way it has to be. And so we'll do the very best that we can, and we'll dive into the details. We'll surround ourselves with good people, and we'll identify the next leader of Husker football.
Back to Mickey for a second. Why him as opposed to anyone else on the staff?
Well, you know, I think that, you know, I went through a lot of folks, too. I mean, you can naturally make certain arguments certain places, and, you know, Mickey's not calling the plays. You know, Coach Whipple is, and so there's a lot of responsibilities for the head coach that lie outside of football. You can only imagine with, you know, Fox coming this weekend, and, you know, we need to have Coach Whipple focused on game planning and play calling all week, and obviously defensively we've got some fairly significant adjustments to make, and so Chins has got to be really focused there. And so And I, again, I think that Mickey, his personality, his energy and enthusiasm, we need a different voice, right? We need to provide hope for these young men. I mean, you've got a lot of young men in that locker room that at the end of the day, football's a tough sport. You have to force yourself to do things you don't want to do physically. And so having somebody that can pull that out of you and motivate you to do that, and in my observations of Coach Joseph, I think he has some of those attributes, and I'd like to see him function in that role.
Was there anyone else relieved their duties today, or was it just Coach Frost?
Just Coach Frost. Now, again, Mickey Joseph is the head coach, and if he chooses to make some of those additional changes, we will support those changes as well. But I am not aware of any of those that he anticipates at this time. Thank you.
Athletic Director Trev Alberts on the firing of Scott Frost. Frost's tenure as Nebraska head coach ends three games into his fifth season of coaching here in Nebraska. He was hired in 2017 by then Athletic Director Bill Moose. Frost came from the University of Central Florida, where he was National Coach of the Year the previous season. His record at Nebraska is 16 wins, 31 losses. Never took the Huskers to a bowl game. Two-thirds of his losses at Nebraska were by a touchdown or less. As we noted, Frost's contract was restructured last November, reducing his salary from $5 million to $4. Four assistant coaches were fired. Frost's buyout was reduced from $15 million to $7.5 million, but only if he was fired after October 1st of this year. So as Trev Alberts says, it appears the $15 million buyout is still in play.
Right. Now, Alberts also said that he needed a new voice, a different voice. So Nebraska is committing to interim head coach Mickey Joseph for the remainder of this season. He becomes the first black head coach at Nebraska in any sport. Like Frost, Joseph is a former Husker quarterback. He joined the program as a coach this season after the firings last fall. And before he joined Nebraska, he was an assistant head coach at LSU. In fact, Joseph was on the LSU staff when they won the national championship in 2019. And he is well-traveled. Before LSU, Joseph coached at Louisiana Tech, Grambling State, Alcorn State, Langston University, Central Oklahoma, Nicholls State, Alabama State, Tulane, and Nebraska's Wayne State College. He was also an assistant at Omaha North High in 1995 and 96, and he played for the Huskers for four seasons under Tom Osborne starting in 1988.
Let's go live to sports director Andy Kenny and Sean Callahan live at Memorial Stadium. Andy.
Well, Julie Robb, a tough day, according to Trev Alberts, and a sad and unfortunate situation. That is why we are here today. Scott Frost has been fired as the head coach of the University of Nebraska's football team after going 16-31, this in his fifth season. So let's get right to it. Trev talked for about 20 minutes. This is our Big Red Zone insider, Sean Callahan, HuskerOnline.com. Sean, what was your take on Trev's comments?
Well, you know, obviously this is a decision he said he never really wanted to come to, but the bottom line is the win-loss record. Nebraska has not been where they need to be. The way this season started out, you know, it just had to feel like it wasn't going in the right direction. And in the market that we're in and the climate that we're in of college football, you really can't sit around and wait. And, you know, I don't know if there was really ever a good time to do this, but when you have a game like last night where Nebraska gave up more yards than in the history of Memorial Stadium, a 1-2 start with Oklahoma coming in, I think now was the time to make this decision.
5-22 in one score game, Scott Frost was here at the University of Nebraska. And I want to ask you how surprised you are that we are here today talking about this. About 5 years ago, we thought this was trending upward and there was nothing that could stop it.
Yeah, you think about where we were at almost 5 years ago up here with the announcement of Scott Frost, and, you know, this felt like a 25-year hire. You know, that this was a guy that was going to be here until he was 65 years old. He was going to win a lot of games. Nebraska was going to win a lot of Big Ten West championships and compete for the league. And it just has never taken hold. I mean, we can go back to year one. The first game was called off for lightning.
Right.
And then they started 0-6 after that. You know, this thing never really fully got off the ground. I felt like last year there was a little moment where it looked like it could. The Michigan State game they blew, but then the Northwestern game where it really clicked. And then the next week they had Michigan, the Big Ten champions, tied in the final minutes. That was a moment where, like, okay, maybe this is kind of turning a corner. But obviously the way things have started this year, it just doesn't look like this was going to work. And, you know, Trev made the decision, like, hey, we're going to do this, and he's going to get the full $15 million. Like, at this point, I think the damage to the brand in Nebraska has been so strong that, you know, $7.5 million at this point, I don't think is a big deal in the big picture when you talk about the image and the brand of this program.
Yeah, culture over money, I think, was the big thought process here. And when we talked about in the offseason the changes that he made big changes. Gave Mark Whipple the offensive play calling duties, added a couple other assistants, fired some of his longtime friends, and yet in the opener we saw some of the same things happen over and over again, which led to another close loss. And the one common denominator was the head coach.
Yeah, you know, you go back to Ireland, the onside kick decision. I mean, they had an 11-point lead. They could have won the opener. And, you know, our videographer Greg was down there on the sideline next to Trev Alberts. He goes, they're up 11. And they do that onside kick, and you could just feel the game turn. And he said, I could just see Trev's body language at that moment changing. And I remember after that game in Ireland, Big Ten Commissioner Kevin Warren came up on the field, consoled Trev Alberts, kind of saying, hey, I kind of know what's coming. And, you know, we got you here. You know, we know this is, you've got some tough days ahead of you, probably the way this looks right now for Nebraska, and here we are today. But you look at the changes. I mean, the offense did get better, it looked like. The special teams have improved, in, at least in the punting area. But the thing that we didn't expect was the defense. You know, that was supposed to be kind of the steady Eddie of things with Eric Shenander being a fifth-year guy after the success they had at times last year. So I think that's probably the biggest surprise of the way this year has fallen apart is the way the defense came unraveled.
All right, one final question for you. Mickey Joseph takes over. He is obviously well-respected both inside the locker room and outside. What will he bring? He's got 9 games to kind of show some progress, and he is a candidate, as Trev Alberts says, to be the next head coach here.
Yeah, you know, he's a player's guy. He's brought a lot of these new players to the roster, some of the good players, but I think in this time you need a guy that's going to be accessible to the players. Mark Whipple's not that kind of guy. He's an X's and O's, really detailed, almost NFL type guy. The way the defense has played, I couldn't see them obviously going to Eric Shenander. So Mickey Joseph makes a lot of sense to be in this role. He's a former Husker. He's a former Husker quarterback. And he wants this challenge. I think Mickey looks at – I kind of look at it like when Ed Orgeron was at USC and they had to promote him as a non-coordinator for Pete Carroll. This is kind of the same thing at Nebraska, a guy like that. It's not a coordinator, not a play caller, just more of a overall coach that's well-respected in the locker room.
Well, Mickey Joseph will get his chance. Scott Frost finishing his career at 16-31, 0-13 against AP top 25 teams, and he went 1-10 against Minnesota, Iowa, and Wisconsin. Now, Mickey's first game in the Huskers is this Saturday against Oklahoma. It's going to be the Sooners' first trip to Memorial Stadium since 2009. Plenty more coverage we'll have on KETV and KETV.com. But for now, for Sean Callahan, I'm Andy Kendi reporting live from Memorial Stadium as Scott Frost has been relieved as head coach of the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
All right, thanks, guys. And Trev Alberts started his news conference saying, this is a day I hoped would never come.
Now, a tough day.
A tough day. Yes. And we're getting reaction. NU President Ted Carter today said the university is grateful for everything Scott Frost has done for the school and the Huskers as a player, coach, and leader. Unfortunately, said Carter, the results on the field just aren't there. Nebraskans expect us to compete for championships, as do I. Carter also says, we had all hoped to see our program move in the right direction, but with Oklahoma and Big Ten play still ahead of us, it's clear we need to make a change. Difficult as this decision is, I fully support AD Albert's path forward, and I have complete confidence in interim coach Joseph.
And UNL Chancellor Ronnie Green says he knows Frost approached the job like any Nebraskan would, with heart, hard work, and absolute commitment. Green says he knows Frost gave it his all, but unfortunately, after the disappointing beginning to what they hope will be a fresh start, it's time for a change.
Well, stay with KETV News Watch 7 and KETV.com as this story develops.
More coverage on KETV News Watch 7 at 5:30.